Good morning, Interweb. Let's world build. Here's a fun idea. Let's reimagine the history of Earth, except with rings. Hold on, Earth? Rings? Is that even possible? Well, Saturn has rings, Jupiter has rings, Uranus has rings, Neptune has rings. Hell, we've even found two centaurs at rings, Caraclo and Chiron. So if big things can have rings and little things can have rings, why not intermediate things too? I mean, none of the leading ring formation theories exclusively rule out the possibility of terrestrial rings. And we're not talking man-made rings of space junk either, we got those. We're talking 100% organic, naturally occurring, geologically stable terrestrial ring systems. However improbable, terrestrial rings are possible. As for Earth in particular, well, it's complicated. In my opinion, the best Earth ring formation scenario goes like this. Back in the early days of the solar system after the Earth and the Moon formed, a wandering asteroid got a little too close to Earth and was captured. Over time, the asteroid's orbit decayed to such an extent that the Earth's tidal forces ripped it apart, and the resulting debris formed the rings of Earth. So we're gonna need an asteroid. Meet 48 Doris, an actual real-life main-belt asteroid I'll use to model our hypothetical asteroid off. Now, as Doris approaches Earth, she'll eventually cross what's known as the Earth's Roche Limit. The Roche Limit is the theoretical boundary around any astronomical object, outside of which satellites can exist, but inside of which they'll be torn apart and form rings. As such, the outer boundary of any ring system will always be at the Roche Limit. Unless otherwise acted upon, rings would exist entirely within this region. The Roche limit is given by 2.44 times r, the radius of the primary, multiplied by the cube root of the density of the primary divided by the density of the secondary. In this case, Earth is our primary and Doris is our secondary. So it's 2.44 times the radius of the Earth, 1, cause as always we're working in Earth units, times the cube root of the density of Earth, again 1, divided by the density of Doris, which Wikipedia tells me is roughly 0.38 times as dense as Earth. Run the numbers and we'll find that the outer limit lies 3.37 Earth radii from the centre of Earth, which, to scale, is about here. It's worth noting that the Roche limit depends on the ratio of the densities. An asteroid made of solid iron, say, would get much closer to Earth without being torn apart. The size of any ring system will depend primarily on the density of the moon, comet, or asteroid from which they formed. High-density objects yield tight-in rings, low-density objects yield more expansive rings. Now for the inner boundary. This will likely coincide with the outer limit of the Earth's atmosphere. Why? Because rings need to be totally free of atmospheric drag, lest their orbits decay. So that's beyond the troposphere, beyond the stratosphere, beyond the mesosphere, beyond the thermosphere, and even beyond the exosphere. Earth's atmosphere at its fullest extent is deep. Really deep. 10,000 kilometers deep. So our inner boundary goes here, 2.57 Earth radii from the center of Earth. And hey presto, we got ourselves some Earth rings. 10,000 kilometers above the Earth's surface, we'll find a 5,161 kilometer wide Earth ring. Now the ring's mass will be roughly equivalent to Doris's mass, minus a bit to allow for any material ejected during formation. So again, thanks to Wikipedia, our Earth rings will be about half the mass of Saturn's rings. However, unlike Saturn's icy rings, our Earth rings will be made of silicates. After all, Doris, a rocky asteroid, was made of silicates. This is very important. In the inner solar system, so close to the Sun, plain old sunlight would sublimate the icy ring particles from a solid to a gas, and then the UV rays would break apart the water molecules, i.e. bye-bye ring system. In short, close-in planets should have rocky rings, distant planets, icy rings. Now like Saturn, our Earth rings would be very thin. I ran some crude volumetric equations to roughly gauge the average thickness of our Earth rings. Turns out they're about 9.5 meters thick, which sounds about right given that the average thickness of Saturn's rings is about 10 meters. So that's distance, mass, composition, and thickness covered. What about gaps? The Cassini division is probably the most famous gap in Saturn's rings, but it's hardly alone. Saturn's rings have thousands of gaps, all varying in size. Why? Because moons. Lots of moons. 60 odd moons, in fact. They all interact gravitationally with Saturn's rings, giving rise to the complex structures we see. Earth, with its one abnormally massive moon, will have very different looking rings. The orbital resonances between our moon and the rings will make for a ring system with fewer, more regularly spaced gaps. Think pinstripe rings, kinda like this. Yeah, they're not as visually pleasing, but luckily the moon has another trick up its sleeve, tides. Lunar tides might pull the Earth rings into a spoke configuration, akin to those seen on Saturn's rings. Now, I say luckily, but truth be told, the lunar tides are so strong they'll probably tear apart the rings. Hell, the Earth is so close to the Sun, the solar tides would likely do the same. And this is the it's complicated bit. While terrestrial planets do have the potential to host rings, Earth doesn't. Its setup is just all wrong. Ideally, for Earth to have rings, it would need a smaller moon, and would need to orbit further from the sun. But hey, we're balls deep at this stage, so on with the rampant speculation. Let's talk culture. The Earth rings would certainly play a huge role in shaping the evolution of human culture and society. Standing at the equator, they would appear directly overhead as a thin, bright line running east to west. As you move away from the equator, the rings would appear wider and wider and ever closer to the horizon, to the south in the northern hemisphere and north in the southern hemisphere. Kind of like this, albeit more terrestrial and less Saturnian. They would never set and would, to an extent, be constantly visible, day and night. They would be so apparent that they would change the apparent colour of the moon. The moon is a very dark object. We only perceive it as being so incredibly bright because relative to the blackness of the night sky, it is really bright. Relative to our Earth rings, the moon may seem darker. A dark grey, perhaps. Imagine the rich mythological tradition that would arise centred on this great celestial arc and its grey companion. That is, if there even were humans around to create those mythologies. See, the ring would cast a shadow on the Earth's surface, resulting in colder winters in both hemispheres. A lot colder, possibly inhospitably cold. Plants and animals, if they even evolved, would have to develop methods to deal with the colder temperatures and decreased amounts of light. It's not all bad, though. Joseph Schur of quantum rocketry speculates that if the Earth were ringed, and humans were around, the progress of science would be rapidly accelerated. Using nothing but the naked eye and some basic geometry, it would be possible for ancient cultures to look at the rings and figure out A. the Earth's axial tilt, B. that the Earth and the Moon are spherical, C. the distance to the Moon, D. that the solar system is heliocentric, E. the relative brightness of distant stars, and F. the distances to those stars. All from just studying how the shadows of the Earth and the Moon interact with the rings, and how much of a star's light the rings block as the star passes behind them. The ancient Greeks or Chinese, using nothing but the sacks of fluid embedded in their faces, would have been able to tell you the rough distance to the stars. Just from looking up at the rings. Madness. Hell, the Romans, they might have been able to tell you what a parsec is. And I might have lived on Mars. Who knows? Well, actually, I do. See, spaceflight is a tricky undertaking at the best of times. Imagine the complications a 5,000 kilometer wide ring of rocky debris, aka space shrapnel, would cause. At best, spaceflight would be really complicated, at worst, impossible. Any launch trajectories would need to be carefully plotted so as to go over or under the rings. Satellites would also have to avoid the rings, which is difficult considering directly above the equator is the best place to put them. Many of the Earth's current satellites regularly plow through the region the rings would occupy. And even if humans found safe orbits for their satellites, the ring particles may scatter any incoming radio waves, thus rendering weather, communications, military, GPS, and spy satellites useless. All in all, terrestrial rings are not that crazy a concept to think about. They'd be awesome to look at, great for the advancement of pre-scientific societies, but they'd ultimately hinder any spacefaring civilization. Unless, of course, Stargates!
Good morning, Interweb. So first off, I have to apologize. It's been a seriously long time since the last video. Writing the script to this video took an awful lot longer than I had anticipated. So yeah, that's why it's been so long. Apologies. As always, it's nearly impossible to fully cover an entire topic in a single video. So if you have any questions or there's anything you're unsure about, throw something in the comments, I'll be down there to sort you out. Also, I just want to make it clear, I'm not like pioneering this line of speculation, others have gone before me, and I want to give credit where credit's due. So I strongly recommend checking out Joseph Schur's blog, I'll leave links in the doobly-doo, and Bad Astronomy, again, doobly-doo, and actually just a whole load of other links to really awesome people who have looked into this topic of ringed terrestrial planets. Anyways, click the links on screen or in the description for more Artifexian content, like, and if you think I earned it, hit the subscribe button. Thank you all so much for watching. Edgar out.